4447 South Boulevard. This is an address that your trainer, Robert Gibson, should know very well, Landon Hale. This used to be the Crockett headquarters, Crockett offices. And every week, Robert Gibson would come here, fulfilling his dream of being a professional wrestler. He'd come here, he'd pick up his check, and he would move on to the next town. Now, your trainer had a wonderful, amazing, long career teaming with Ricky Morton, and I respect them for that. But you took it too far when you called me a coward. The reason I'm here, the reason I'm showing this building, is to remind you that coming up, you won't have a career no more, Landon Hale. There is no more career for you. There is no more happiness. There is no more joy. You had such potential to make it, but you wasted it away by calling me out. It's career versus career, Landon Hale. And yours is coming to an end. I'm not done. I'll never be done. The day I'm done, you carry me out in a pine box. But you, Landon Hale, your career ends before it ever begins. Enjoy the view, Landon. This is the closest to a pay office in professional wrestling you'll ever have. I'll see you at APCW. Adamz vs. Hale 3. Career versus career. Toma.
Welcome to the APCW. This is your host, Mr. Green, and we are kicking things off with the big man, the enforcer of Angel's Army, Elrod Campbell, Mr. Campbell to you, and behind him, Alister Crowe. Angel has been systematically placing her men in positions to unseat power in APCW. And I think this is just yet another step along the way. Look at that face right there. You know, it's hard to believe once upon a time Alister Crowe was one of the most beloved individuals that APCW had, but now the money talks. I guess that is the old phrase, money talk, BS walks. I'm not going to say it this particular broadcast, but you get the idea. Campbell over here having words with the paying audience, some of which, as you can see right there, are not very happy with him, as most people are not, even though he demands their respect. They're going, boo, they're not happy with Mr. Campbell. Southern Justice, Mr. Campbell, to you. If there's any one thing that we can say about Elrod, is that he is a force to be reckoned with. You cannot take him lightly, regardless of whether you disagree, dislike him or any other member of Angel's Army. I mean, he's there for a reason. He is labeled an enforcer there and in the muscle for a reason. Often, more often than not, he can get the job done. So that brings in the question, who will be the man to step up and try to take the challenge today? Elrod paces like a tiger, caged animal. Who we have, Bryan Montgomery, the Purdy boy. And And yes, that is pronounced correctly. If you ever get a chance, and I'm not encouraging that to check out his rear end, but if you ever get a chance to check out the tights, you see that that is how it is pronounced. I know some fans out there try to do it properly. They say pretty, but that is not how he presents it. There's Pretty going doing his spiel. He hops up into the ring, getting prepared to take on the task facing Angel's Army. Well, not both of them, but you get the idea. As Alister Crowe bores a hole into his soul, staring at him.
Introducing first to my right, heading from Owensboro, Kentucky, escorted to the ring by Angel's Army, Angel, along with. Alister Crowe, weighing in at 265 pounds, Mr. Elrod Campbell.
There he is, Elrod Campbell. Not sure what kind of response he's expecting from him. He got up on the rope like he was expecting some cheers, but we all know better than that.
Heading from Knoxville, Tennessee. Weighing 220 pounds, the Pretty Boy, Montgomery.
We have Mr. Montgomery. Once again, this response is going to be drastically different than Elrod's.
Time limit.
Hey, sweetheart.
Okay, well, apparently that was a little bit of a show for Angel, but I'm not sure if she quite appreciated that. Coming from Bryan. She saw Elrod shielding her eyes from the lewd gestures. I guess they would probably consider it Mr. Montgomery, the Pretty Boy. But it will not be about how well he can swivel his hips at this stage. It's about whether he can offset the big man. The bell's rung. So he's going to have to get it focused, already getting the crowd on his side, so that may be a plus for him, get some momentum. You see Angel at top of the screen, she's holding her ears, even though she can't stand it, the support for somebody else. Well, right off the bat, we have to talk about the advantage that Elrod had. Not only is Elrod a bigger, probably stronger man, I mean, it might be safe to assume that he's stronger. I mean, I don't want to discount Montgomery, because he could be deceptively strong, but Elrod also has in his corner the managerial services of Angel and the assistance of Alister Crowe, so that in my mind is already leading a little bit of leverage to Campbell's side. There's the locker. If Montgomery's smart, he's going to have to do what he can to keep himself away from not just that corner, just away from Alister Crowe and Angel in general. You know, Angel's going to be firing out some level of instructions no matter where Elrod is in the ring. But if Bryan can manage to keep himself away from that, he might be able to prevent any sort of physical altercation. Side headlock applied by Montgomery, holding Elrod down. Elrod using that power that I was talking about just shoved him off. Elrod looks perpetually angry. Not really a happy camper, I can say that. Size up the situation again. Rear waist lock applied by Montgomery. Again with the side headlock. Montgomery trying to lock it down, taking it to a wrist lock. Reversal. Elrod Campbell into a top wrist lock. Despite the fact that you would expect him to use a lot of strength, nice takedown by Montgomery. Arm drag. I was going to say, despite the fact that you would expect him to utilize his strength, he's actually attempting to out-wrestle Montgomery. That could prove to be a mistake. That's a quick shot right to the bicep. Brian Montgomery keeping Elrod down. He's trying to work himself back up to a standing position, and he did a knee lift right into the abdomen of Bryan Montgomery. Forearm shot across the back. This is exactly where Campbell wants him, down, out, and hurt. forearm shot right to the lower back. And you see it's like a well-oiled machine. Look at Angel. Elrod backs it up. Referee's not looking. Angel moves in for the kill. Not surprising. If you look close, you see Alister Crowe over there laughing. Which should surprise no one. I'm sure that at this stage he finds the misfortunes of other rather humorous. Which I'm a little, again, you know, it's hard to believe that once upon a time he was one of the most popular men here. And look at him. It's, you know, pretty much. Siding with Angel's army instantly makes you hate it. And you have to go back and look at some of the footage. And I mean, it wasn't even for anything beyond, well, pay me more and I'll join. And that was what she did. And so he did. He joined up. Elrod trying to possibly choke out his opponent. But the referee's down there, good for him, checking to make sure that the airway is clear. Montgomery trying to break himself free, back up on his feet. A couple shots off to Elrod into the ropes. And he ran right into a brick wall there when he caught that elbow. Elrod just put him back down over the cup. There's a two count. Montgomery is out. And a suplex. Big impact. Montgomery's now, he's reaching. He's trying to get some, trying to get something from somewhere, from somebody. You can see right there, he might be off in a little bit of a daze. He had to verify that it was just a two count from the referee. So his instincts were good. He got himself out of it, but he is he's riding off of steam right now. And you can see it again. There's the distraction play. Elrod backs it up. The referee is telling him not to choke out anymore. But meanwhile, Alistair's choking on under his second rope behind him. And I think you look at his face and say, what are you talking about? What am I doing? Campbell winds up with that big right hand. And he measured it off. A slap in the face by Angel. Again, this is exactly what I was talking about at the beginning of it. Elrod, in and of himself, you would imagine, has an advantage over Montgomery, but that isn't enough. He's actually utilizing both of his seconds, if you will, on the outside. And if you just saw that camera shot, you saw the entire ring move. How Elrod just shot him into the turbo to post there. That should give you an idea of how hard Elrod slung him in, if nothing else. And these are big, deliberate shots by Elrod Campbell. Reversal. Montgomery almost caught him into a modified power slam there, but it wasn't enough. You see the frustration by the pretty boy. He was trying to turn this thing around. Almost did. Almost managed to get a quick turnaround there. Elrod's a little bit dazed from what Montgomery did there. He just caught with another modified power slam, almost out of a driver position, but I think that might, just hoisting Elrod up, probably taking every bit of strength and effort that he had left in him. Now both men are down. The referee's counting. Elrod trying to get himself to his feet, as is Bryan Montgomery. Top of the screen, you see Angel screaming at the fans, also wanting to encourage her man to get back up to his feet. Both of them back up now. Elrod driving a big right hand. Montgomery comes back with the right hand and is off. Forearm shot drives Montgomery to the turnbuckles. Again, you gotta look at that power from Elrod Campbell. Slings him across. That was in coast to coast. Charges in with an avalanche splash. Montgomery not looking good right now. To the other side. Elrod charges back in, but this time he catches a knee. And a sling blade by Bryan Montgomery. Hooks the leg. But not enough weight across the shoulders to keep Elrod Campbell down. Montgomery is looking a little fresh, man. Thought that would be it. How did he get up? reversal by Campbell. Montgomery flips himself out. I saw him just catch him in the side of the head with that kick at the top of the screen. That was Montgomery looking for a roll-up. Elrod rolls through, but Montgomery was right on the money. He got himself up and popped it with like a side kick. Reaching back to hook the leg, but didn't get it up. That minor thing might have been the mistake. He did not get the leverage on Elrod because he couldn't get his leg up. Tried as he might. He's looking to hoist him up in the fireman's carry position. Elrod fights himself out of it. Now is Elrod for perhaps a Uranage slam, which he did connect. And two, three. Well, I wish I could say that it was surprising, but it is not. As talented as Montgomery is, it is not surprising that Elrod Campbell to come away with the win. The big man has scored for Angel's Army, and you can see the glee on Angel's face right now. Is this a good omen for Angel's Army? As it is not the only time that she will be represented tonight. Will this be it? Is this the start of it?
Mr. Elrod Campbell.
She's asking for people to cheer, but not quite. They're not wanting to. Now we have the tag team match. A return tag team match of sorts. Recon, Zach Mosley getting an opportunity to face off against the champions again. And you can only imagine that a victory over the champions will replace them as a top contender for the championships. So it is a very important match, if nothing else, to get them back into title contention. Mosley, who has made himself very clear that he does not like Douglasville, Georgia. He does not even want to be associated with or represent the city that he was born in. Apparently, Zach Mosley is very fond of renaming the town and things like Dumpsterville and stuff like that. Not a very hometown-friendly individual. Speaking of not hometown-friendly, not very friendly with the audience either. And here we have the tag team champions. It is your reality check. Zero and the Rude Boy. That's how they come out. They get themselves ready to go. Brandon Shane and Rodney Wayne, the Zero and the Rude Boy, the tag team champions, the reality check. A favorite amongst Douglasville, a favorite amongst APCW. See that this, I said it when they won the championship, this was a moment that they waited a lifetime for. They waited to win these tag teams, but they wanted to be tag team champions. They accomplished that. Oddly enough, one of the individuals that they defeated to become tag team champions in the ring right now was the interim tag team champion at that time. Didn't actually win the belt. He was gifted the title from the then partner, Eric Adamz. So, if nothing else in this match, Recon can technically say he's a former tag team champion. Although it'd be weird for him to say it because he only really held the title for maybe 15 minutes. But it is the reality of the situation. He did walk into a match where he got the opportunity to defend the championship. And now it is them fighting for the position.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, this match was a late breaking. As I got a phone call, I wasn't even sure I had an opportunity to let both teams know before. But according to Mr. Teddy Long, the commissioner contacted. Originally, this was not supposed to be a title match, but then he contacted me to say that you guys will be putting the titles on the line tonight. So,
we got some new news being relayed, so I stand corrected. It is not just for the position any longer. Apparently, according to the ring announcer, it is now straight up for the championships.
Title match is scheduled for one fall.
And this has got to be a thrill. For Mosley and Recon. And I know the Recon are not afraid to defend the titles. You saw their faces right there. They were perfectly fine with defending the championships.
And his tag team partner, hailing from Paris Island, weighing 195 pounds, ladies and gentlemen, Recon. Once again, this match is for the APCW.
Here we have the reality check. Maybe he's going to be tag team champions. And the defending tag team champions. Like I said, they walked into this in what was advertised as a non-title match. It is now turned around. It will be for the tag team championships. Reality check did not have any issues with doing it, but you have to imagine that it may throw the game off. Zach Mosley and Recon have been campaigning for this, and apparently the campaign has won. They are now challenging for the titles. They have another opportunity. Will they make the most of it as Mosley just forces Rodney into the ropes? Rodney pot-faced him off. He has some extremely talented young men here in the ring. Who will be able to out-wrestle the next? Rodney applies a full Nelson. Mosley trying to, trying to find an escape there. He was going to walk the ropes and maybe perhaps push himself off into a pin position, but Rodney just outfought it and let him go. Rude Boy is, like he's feeling good tonight. I can say that, but side headlock applied. Right on Mosley for the, high flying ability, but for the agile style that Mosley has, I would think that Rubo would want to keep him grounded in some level as he just caught him with a hip toss. Arm drag sets Zach Mosley down. Perhaps that is the plan because he is now grounded. There's a wink of the eyes by Mosley. Here comes Recon, but Recon walks right into a clothesline and now he's catching shots in the face. Ryan is asking, I'm saying, come on. There's a tie up. Arm drag by Ryan. Recon charged it again, but he got caught with another arm drag as Ryan bars out the arm. Rude Boy trying to maintain control here in this matchup. Duck underneath perhaps a tip of a clothesline. Out of the backdrop, and now Recon tags out and brings Mosley back in. Rude Boy stands his ground. And they're looking to perhaps do a little bit of a knuckle lock. have a shortcut by Mosley, caught him in the stomach, and that drove him into the corner. Perhaps he's looking to apply a hammerlock here. Turns into a side headlock, brings it down, takes him over, but that gets him caught in the legs as he kicks out. Mosley brings him back now. Answers it again. Mosley able to kick out a second time. And we have a bit of a stalemate between the two. Recon and Mosley. You can see Mosley's telling people, shut up. I think he's getting a little distracted. Oh boy, just. I don't know if I agree with necessarily that tactic. He just essentially fought him right back into his corner. But he, again, I said it earlier, he's feeling good, and he must be, because he just took one partner out, taking on the next. That was Recon in the ring. He just tagged himself in, and he's fallen to the fists and the elbows of the Rude Boy. As it stands right now, the tag team champions are in full control of this matchup. The challengers have yet to really find their stride as Recon shoves Rodney off, but Rodney comes back in, catches him with a knee lift, followed by an elbow, then a headbutt. Recon's looking for the tagging. So you have to wonder how long can the Rude Boy maintain this pace. And there's clearly a lot of energy wrapped in that body right now, but like a candle, he may burn himself out. He's off into the corner. There's Rodney, right headbutt right to the chest. Takes him out. There's the tag. And now we got the zero. Brandon Shane is, Rodney holds him steady. Double axe handle. Now the zero, barring out the arm. He's trying to bring Mosley back up to his feet, force him up to the ropes, but didn't wait for the break, tossed him in, clothesline. Mosley takes him down. That might be the window opportunity he's looking for as he tags out to his partner. Recon's in the ring. Recon shoots into the ropes. He was trying for a perhaps a butterfly lock suplex or some other double arm attempt, but Shane, Brandon, was able to counter it and take him over. Side headlock. And Brandon Shane in control now. Reality check have not come up short very often in this match. Flying head scissors or hurricanrana, whichever you prefer. But the zero is still in full control. Reversal by Recon. And a clothesline takes the zero down. Another quick tag. You know who has tagged in more often than not in this match. There's the. That might be the moment right there where he just posted him in the corner. See Rodney trying to encourage his partner to get over and make the tag. And Mosley's certainly not going to allow that to happen as he just grabs Rodney and whips Brandon down with another ring. Could potentially get a submission there, but smart wrestling by Brandon Shane turned it into a pinfall. It looks like getting into a pinning position again. If he's down to check. But Mosley was able to whip himself out of it, wiggle free. And that's smart, great pinning position. Great pinning position right there. But not enough to keep the zero down. Turns it around. And I I think this is the position that Mosley and Recon want to be in, where they can get some control and do maneuvers like that, a decapitation, double team off the second rope. And it wasn't enough. But the confidence level has got to be rising. Forearm shot across the back of Brandon Chan. And another forearm. Rude boy over there just stopping, trying to get some motivation up at this point. Trying to get him encouraged to make that tag. But will he be able to do it? Mosley and Recon have waited for this moment. They had been down in the dumps essentially for the opening portion of this. I guess he just invited himself in. There was no tag, but now he's just come on in. Referee's trying to gain some level of control here. Looks like that. Ref having a hard time getting the Rodney out. Brandon's on the outside. No, excuse me, Rico's on the outside. Brandon's going to the outside. But the ref is trying to tell him, hey, there's no tag here. You got to get out. It might not be a popular call by the referee, but it is a good call by the referee. I know the fans wanted Rodney in there, but they cannot do that. Brandon's back in the ring. Zach is on the ground after he took a pummeling by Rodney. Mosley placed him up in the Kryptonite Crunch. Made famous by Nova. That's from ECW years for you younger fans out there. Trying to score that pinfall, trying to get that one big move that's going to allow them to win this match, because this is the opportunity of opportunities that they've been waiting for. We got Mosley, Recon both in the ring, behind his carry position. Goes into the ropes. Great double team maneuver. Going for the cover. Good position by the referee. Referee Reese is on it. Have to give credit where credit is due. He's going for the cover again as Recon, but no. Brandon Shane gets that right shoulder up off the mat twice. He's still showing fire, showing fight. Not willing to give this thing up yet. He knows what's on the line. It might be a last minute call, but Brandon Shane knows the tag team championships are up for grabs right here. Goes for another hit. Hurricanrana, but that got turned into a powerbomb. And that could do it. Wayne, I think, realizes that it was close. That might have been it. He might have felt like the titles were slipping away right there. Came in to save it. Now Recon's turning over to like a reverse cloverleaf. He's got great position on it, keeping him away from the ropes, walking him backwards. Brandon Shane is almost in arm's reach of it right now. He's crawling with everything he's got. He made it. Made it over to ropes. Got that hand on him. Recon holding on, stretching out that count. And also trying to make sure that he does not get jumped from behind. That was good ring awareness. And this is where they kind of bending the rules here. They saw him slap the hands in the air and then switch themselves out. So there it was. Officially no tag, but I guess this is one of those moments where the referee couldn't catch it. Brandon's trying to get himself motivated. And he is back up to his feet. He's fighting back. Right hand to Zach Mosley. Yeah, right now there he's still hollering out, trying to get him focused. Right back, big knee lift in the corner. And that could have been a knockout shot right there. That could legitimately be a knockout shot. Taking him back over to the corner. The tags in and out for the challengers have been frequent and they have been consistent. Back in fireman's carry position, what will it be? whatever it was going to be, and it turned into a DDT by Brandon Shane. And that might be the window of opportunity that he needed to get over to his partner and make the tag. And he's doing everything he can to try to get back over there. I think Recon's making a quick decision here. Should I stop or should I make the tag? He chose to make the tag out to his partner as well. But now on the other side, you got two tags. Mosley and Wayne, both of them, ooh, double leg tripping. Now he's raining down right hands. That's a combat clothesline. We will call it that because it can't be Cactus's clothesline any longer. Double arm suplex by Rodney Wayne to Zach Mosley. It was great execution on that, but he was unable to follow up. On the outside, looks like Recon posted Brandon into the outside ring post. That may have effectively eliminated him from the match. Rear waist lock by Zach Mosley. But whatever he's trying to do, Rodney is fighting short on clothesline, but he couldn't connect. Now roll up by Wayne. And he's got him. Reps counting two. Recon got him with a DDT. I think he just caught the tail end of that, but not enough. One, two, three. Referee's asking for it, but he just counted three, and then asking now is too late. Well, it was a long, hard-fought match. It was a struggle, but I guess he has to get the devil his due. They weathered the storm, and here they are, the tag team champions, Zach Mosley and Recon, have managed to win APCW tag team titles for a match that was never scheduled to be tag team championship in the first place. We got some air guitar going on there. His first championships in this promotion. Saying they told you. Well, I guess not technically the first for Recon, but we will bypass that. This is the first one that he's won. Situation for the, I guess now former tag team champions, the reality check. Like I said, they didn't walk into this thing even realizing that the titles were going to be on the line, to give them credit where it's due. They were game for it. But the quick adjustments by Mosley and Recon saw them through and saw them win the championships. But I'm sure there'll be another day for the reality check.
Puts Elrod Campbell down, delivered by Oliver Steele. It's winding it up. Spear. That's going to do it. Oliver Steele's been. Oh. Well, Oliver Steele's going to win the match, but not in the way that he or I would have expected or liked. Tommy Penirelli has come in to cost this match. Got his stick bat with him. His apparent weapon of choice. He has a grudge that he is just going to take out on Oliver Steele no matter what.
We just saw the recap. And if you've been paying attention to the past couple of videos, or you've been on the Facebook page, you know that Tommy Penirelli has really developed a real issue with Oliver Steele. As highlighted by the assault that he had with that thing in his right hand right now, that stick bat that he likes to carry around. Penirelli is a well, now he's threatening the ring announcer. And he really hasn't had any problems threatening most APCW persons or personnel. But the person that has drawn the ire of his wrath more often than not in recent weeks has been the strongman Oliver Steele. Hits this match, which is more or less a grudge of sorts. And it should be interesting because it's one thing to do it when Oliver Steele is not looking. But will he be able to apply this same sort of beatdown to him when he is staring at the man face to face? Especially since Oliver Steele does come with a bit of an equalizer of his own. And there's his equalizer right there. That mighty mallet that he carries in his left hand. And if I were a betting man, I would say that that mallet probably has a lot more oomph behind it than the average stickback. But then again, and here we go again, threatening more personnel. That's it. But then again, the way that Tommy Penirelli swings it can quite possibly be as deadly as the mallet. You see Steele taking advice from the fans. He's like, should I bring them, use the mallet? And he's taking it in there with them. And it's a smart decision. And having talked to Oliver Steele before, I know that he does not take Tommy Penirelli lightly. He's actually, surprisingly, giving the man credit for how good he is. First APCW champion. And quite honestly, Penirelli does not get nearly the credit he deserves as being the first APCW champion. It's not a envied position to be the first. In most cases, you have to carry the ball. He is Tommy Penirelli.
Hailing from Gary, Indiana, weighing in at 305 pounds, the strongman, Oliver Steele. Once again, this is a no disqualification match. We warn you folks on the front row, please be mindful of that. Once again, a no DQ match. Scheduled for one call.
Just heard it from the ring announcer. I know what they're getting into. Basically, as just announced, you can basically just say whatever we got in our hands right now is perfectly legal. But now you may have just heard Steele say, I don't need it. I don't need it. You just put the mallet down. Which clearly Tommy finds amusing. Steele is a rather large, powerful individual. I would say that size and strength easily on his side. Penirelli knows what he's doing between those ropes. And you notice, despite the fact that Steele has put the mallet down, Tommy has not put down the stick. He's asking people, he's asking the fans, should I put it down? Just heard him. You want me to put it down? He just charged in, tried to get a good shot at. Oh! That was a big clothesline by Oliver Steele, who moves deceptively fast for a large man. And I'll send him into the turnbuckle. Keep in mind, both of those things are still in the ring. Not a good place for it to be. Easily losing footing, stepping on that one. Roll underneath the soles. Big backdrop. I guess you don't have to worry about that now. He'd have just kicked it out of the way. Good for them. But now, Oliver Steele goes for the stick back. Tommy knows, I gotta get out of here. Because that will probably be as much retribution and revenge as Steele is looking for. He caught it across his back How about a couple of weeks ago? And trying to, he's teasing, picking up now. He doesn't want it either. He prefers his weapon of choice. If anything, probably a quicker, more repetitive hit. And now we have Alister essentially playing King of the Mountain. He's keeping Tommy Penirelli out. Penirelli is trying to find the window into the ring and still lets him in. He just ran in and got caught. Another shot. Now we're going to go back to the raw power that is a strong man. Trying to get that up. Trying to take a swing at his head. But again, deceptively fast as Oliver Steele got himself out of the way. Thumb in the eye. Wasn't fast enough for that one. Didn't see it coming. I guess no pun intended. And he just got caught finally by Penirelli. A second shot by Penirelli. Well, Steele knows what that feels like. He caught it a while back. No. Well, it was going to be a side headlock. That turned into a back suplex, and that was just a case of Steele's superior strength there. And he was able to force Tommy up. To the turnbuckles. Big shot by Oliver Steele. There's another. Penirelli trying to fight his way out of it. Headbutt. I'm not sure if this is a smart decision by Tommy Penirelli. Looks like he's trying to get him off his feet with a suplex, but that got reversed, and now Steele's got him hoisted up high. And after a short delay, brings Tommy Penirelli down, almost center of the ring. One, two. Got the shoulder up, but not with the authority. And there's a blatant choke. But there's no disqualification. Referee can complain about it, but he really can't do anything about it. Penirelli gets himself out of the ring. He's trying to put some distance between himself and Oliver Steele. In this case, Steele seems determined. And following that choke, I would say he seems like he's wanting to lay in the pain, not just get a win. He's pressing to the post there. But I was still down, still on the floor. Doesn't look like he knows where he is. Penirelli, from out of nowhere with a trash can here. Looks like it's gonna be, a second shot, and Oliver still goes down. Will the third time be the charm for Tommy Penirelli as he's sizing him up one more time? He caught him right there at the top of the head. And Steele met the top of the skull of Oliver Steele. And you can see the confidence has crept back up into Penirelli's persona there. Closing in on what might be the potential win, going for a fourth shot, but still saw it coming. Kicked him in the abdomen, took the trash can lid away, and now bringing the thunder on Tommy Penirelli. Mafioso is down. The right shoulder comes up off the mat, saves him from loss. But really, how many more times do either man have within him? that, oh, the mallet. The hallmark of Oliver Steele. Tommy is not wanting any part of that. He said, no, no, please. Tommy looking to shake hands now. Looks like Steele is actually considering it. Go. No! A big shot from the top end of that mallet. Right into the stomach. And it. Oh! And there's another one. Tommy Penirelli's a tough guy, but I doubt that even he would be able to handle that. Speaking of tough. Two shots by that gigantic mallet right into his stomach, and somehow he still found a way out. But I'm telling you, this is everything that Oliver Steele has been wanting. This is revenge, and I don't know if Tommy Penirelli getting back on his feet bothers Oliver Steele right now. It may just spell a longer beating from Oliver Steele. As he goes outside, looks like he's going to pick up the lid. Coming back in to deliver. Oh! It's amazing that Tom Penirelli is still fighting right now. DDT! Trying to straighten out his weapon of choice here a little bit. He's trying to look like he might have been trying to get it in the corner, but chose just to lay it up on top. Charges in. Steele got the foot up, blocked himself from going into that face first into the lid. Although in doing so, knocked the lid over, which might have been a save for Tommy Penirelli. He would have caught the trash from the lid if not. Both men out to the outside looking for something. Penirelli's got the lid. Steele has got the stick back. Now, one mighty swing knocks the lid right out of Penirelli's hands. And it doesn't look like he being Oliver, was even concerned about using it any longer. He just broke the stick on his... over his knee. He's gonna do it on his own, folks. Penirelli just caught him, and now he's coming up. Looks like off the second rope. He just got caught. Double choke slam, Bob. One, two, three. Oliver Steele just got himself a measure of revenge over Tommy Penirelli right here. Like I said, I don't think Steele ever took Penirelli lightly. And I certainly don't think that he was disappointed that the match went a little bit longer. They gave him the opportunity to dish out that much more punishment. Saw the ring announcer there trying to move the mallet and hand it over to Steele, but he couldn't do it. The same mallet that Steele carries single-handedly. And he's carrying single-handedly out of the ring right now. That is why he's the strong man. And meanwhile in the ring, we got Penirelli. Tom Penirelli's making his exit right now. I'm sure that this is not the outcome that he was looking for. He just grabbed the microphone as the people continue to berate him. Let him speak. guess he didn't have much to say. They're going to try to give him airtime to say what he wanted, but there was no words.
11th, 7 p.m., Airway Christian Academy in Douglasville, Georgia. Landon Hale fights Eric Adamz in one of the biggest fights of his entire life. It's a career versus career match. This is one of the biggest fights that I'm ever going to be in because my career is on the line and my career has barely even started. Eric, I know what you are capable of doing. You've not cheated me only once, not twice, three times. And I'm getting really sick of it. I've been training consistently. I'm making sure that I know what's coming next. I've been in the gym. I've been in the ring. Robert has been training me. It's funny because you reminisce on Robert Gibson and how he's trained, but yet he is training me. Why aren't you in the gym? Are you worried about your career? I understand that you're a vet, but still, you need to be in the ring because you will not know what's coming next. This is like Avengers. This is like Avengers Endgame. This is superhero versus villain. One of us has to go. But just like Endgame, here's a little bit of a spoiler for you. Your career is over.
I know what I want from my rematch. Why don't you put the title on the lines tonight?
Well, what's it gonna be? You're not gonna call me a shit. You want to start fine here? You know what?
Let's have it.
Oh, all right. A one contest is one fall, and it is for the APCW Tag Team Championship.
I'm giving you chance after chance, and I've won each time. And now you want to call me a coward and insult my entire career. Here's what I say. You get a rematch next month under my rules.
Okay, what is it?
If I lose, I'll retire. I'll get out of here. You'll never have to see me again. If I win, I end your career before it begins. You retire. Career versus career. And once we do that, we'll see who's the coward.
It has finally come. Career versus career match. Eric Adamz, Landon Hale. A rivalry that pretty much came out of the loop. I don't think anybody expected for these two to do what they have done in terms of quality of match, amount of time they put against each other and were to escalate to this point. And here we are. A man who is a veteran in the business trying to eliminate somebody who's just started. So we got somebody who's had a career that people are not ready to give it up. It's a young man whose career who hasn't really been good yet. And here's Eric Adams. You can see on his face, I think the reality of this entire situation is just now setting in, that this could be it. So when it came out, there was a little bit more solemn views on it. He kissed the ring, something that he generally does not do. And Eric is, say what you will about him. Some people have booed him. Some people have gone so far as to say that they have hate for him in the ring, but he is an accomplished professional wrestler. He is very good at what he does. But on the other side of that, so is Landon Hale. Speaking of Landon Hale, there he is right here. And I don't think there's any question. I don't think there's any question whatsoever who the crowd is banking on in this instance. Landon Hale is the clear, obvious favorite. See that the excitement that he has brought to the APCW audience.
This is the end of Eric Adams.
He just called it. He said, this is the end of Eric Adams. Those are bold, bold words from Landon Hale. Adams, of course, is very accomplished. And just in the APCW rings, four times APCW Tag Team Champion, two different partners thus far. I guess technically you would say three, if you wanted to include Recon. We talked about that a little bit earlier.
He's kind of an
unofficial name in that slot.
Match. The loser of this match must retire from professional wrestling.
Hale is clearly one of the most accomplished physical specimens I've seen.
Hailing from Charlotte, North Carolina, weighing in at 265 pounds, the Puerto Rican Lion, Eric Adams.
There he is, the Puerto Rican Lion. And he is focused.
And his opponent, hailing from Hikeville, Kentucky.
I don't know if I can even talk enough anymore than what I just did before. Without question, this is the biggest match of that young man's career. The question will it be his last? Landon Hale, as far as APCW artists are concerned, has really been tied up with Eric Adams for the bulk of his career here. From December on down, in some way, shape, or form, he has really been up against one man. One man has been a thorn in his side. It's the man that is standing across the ring from right now. And he feels in his heart, he being Landon Hale, that he can defeat Eric. But Eric did not resort to the chicanery that he does when he does. And now, who's the man? How is this match going to proceed? It's already underway. Neither man is going to look to make a mistake here. We saw Eric do a nice bolt. We're trying to break the grip of Landon Hale. Hale popping the elbow. Out to the floor. Eric Adams goes. And we have to think that at this point, Adams is really thinking about the consequence of this match, the consequence of the actions of calling him out. He didn't just say put your career on the line, he chose to put his own career on the line too. The contract is binding, it's already been made official. I know that
somewhere in his mind, he has to be thinking, what if I lose? What if I slip? What if I make the mistake? Anderson is far more confident. How far will confidence take you? There's a lock him. Side headlock applied. Landon's going to try to bring out this side headlock. Shoves Eric out of his arm. Like a steamroller, he just pops Landon Hale down to the mat. And of course, I think that confidence is starting to come with Eric out of his eyes. It just hurt him. He's the man. Landon's not going to let that disturb him. He's getting the crowd on his side. Easy feat for that young man to do. There's another lockup. Another side headlock. I would anticipate that the match is going to be very methodical up until a point where somebody can go for a huge, big time maneuver, hopefully put the other one away. Right now it is an exchange of holds. I know that these two men can do quite well with each other. I would imagine that they have some familiarity. There's the first bit of frustration that I just saw from Adam Hill. And I'm a bit shocked. But again, much like I said with Adamz, it's probably a case of now the reality of the situation finally settling in. That this could be, if I allow it, if I slip up, the end of my road. Here's looking for an escape. Here shows Landon off. This time it's Landon Hale with the shoulder block. Knocks Eric out a second time. Hale to the ropes. Third time, and Adamz goes out to the sanctuary of the floor. Here comes Landon. Like he might have been going for a drop kick, but he chose better of it. Eric Adamz was making his departure away from the impact zone. And look at him. You can see him pacing out back and forth on the floor. Eric Adamz is thinking this thing over, and the demeanor of Adamz has changed. Not very often do you see fans really engage and text with the match like they are right now. There are plenty of times that they are on the edge of their seats, but they are focused, laser focused, on what's going on right now. I don't know if this is any higher consequences in the APCW ring than what we see right now. Splash attempt by Hale. Here comes Adamz. That window of opportunity was all he was looking for. Got himself out of the way, drove Landon's Hale shoulder first into the post, and now here comes Eric Adamz. Cranking the arm. He's got the damaged goods of Landon Hale. Forearm shot right there on the shoulder blade. The joints. But now is where he's going to try to capitalize on what's going on. Perhaps the top horse like he's trying. Landon was fighting it. He managed to fight it through, but Adamz adjusted. He adjusted the seats and down to a rear chin lock. I doubt very seriously that Landon Hale will submit if he has any say-so in this situation. If he has any say-so of what's going on right now, he is not going to submit. I'll find that very difficult. Able to get himself loose, but he runs into a back elbow. Eric Adamz. Now, confidence is really kicking in gear. Who's the man? A suplex. And he does it with a snap. Drives Landon Hale down to that mat. And you can feel the confidence building moment by moment. Two count. This is where Eric Adamz wants to be, slow, methodical. He can plan every step that he is going to make. He's got him, barred out the arm, bringing Hale back up to his feet. Again, he is staying on the damaged arm, the arm that he threw, the shoulder that he threw into that steel post. Perhaps the game plan here is to keep causing damage, apply an arm bar and secure the submission, or maybe secure the referee by calling the match. Like I said, I don't perceive Landon as good enough, but he may not have an alternative. Oof. You hear that chop sound off. Adamz, full control. Sizing him up for nothing. Another big chop. I literally took Hale off his feet, but that might have motivated him. And now he's got the reversal. He's firing out chops of his own. Here comes the third one. Sends Adamz into the turnbuckle. Here comes Landon. Oh, God. He just caught the big boot by Adamz there. And flying shoulder block. Eric Adamz drove his body right into the face, the chest of Landon Hale. Landon's able to get himself back out of it. It is. Here comes the submission. It looks like he's locking up. Landon's doing everything he can to take that off. He's trying his best to get away right now. And he does it. There was an escape plan, and he got it in. He managed to get over to the ropes. And that might have been the best thing. I can only imagine that if Adamz had gotten that thing locked in, he would have cranked as hard as he could do it. He would have tried to break it. I know that he is going to be very protective of his career, but again, you have to say that Landon Hale is going to be as protective of his as well. These men have got everything on the line professionally. Big full-off shot. He comes down with that Puerto Rican boomstick. That is what Landon Hale is going to watch out for. He's going to have to look out for the official boomstick, that short arm clothesline that Eric Adamz likes to do. He's been very successful. Here comes the neckbreaker. And we just shook the ring with that neckbreaker drop. But not enough to keep Landon Hale down. The heart that's going behind Landon Hale right now is incredible. Hale shoots off. Charges in. This time he catches nothing but a turnover. In-person atomic drop. And another atomic drop, standard style. To the drop kick. Is this the opening that Landon Hale can take advantage of? We'll see. He's rolling away from Eric right now. Himself back up on his feet. I'm sure both of these men are going to be trying to reestablish full control, but it looks like Landon Hale is first up to that. Reverse elbow. First by Adamz. Flying head scissors by Landon Hale takes Eric Adamz over to the corner. That turn on the elbow. Hale sizing up Eric Adamz on the outside of the ring, off into the ropes, special momentum. And he goes out over the top rope onto the floor. Willing to risk it all. And that may be what it takes. Blue Thunderbomb. One, two, no. Swore that was a three count, and it was extremely, extremely close. He's got to stop arguing with the referees. Got to keep going, bro. He plans on winning this match. He's got to remain focused. You see his cheer section over there. They are rooting for that. He's going for his big finish, that full Nelson bomb that he likes to do. Reversal by Adamz. Another big boot. Second time in the match, Eric delivered the boot to the side of the face. Landon Hale. That might have been mostly out of desperation, if anything. Gotta watch out for the full Nelson face plant as much as Hale has got to look out for that short arm clothesline. A little bit of a 619 there. Stop himself from going outside. A counter for the screenshot DDT into a spine buster. Beautiful, but not enough. this is where these two guys' familiarity is starting to work against the other. It's a move that Landon Hale has done a couple of times, a slingshot DDT from the outside in, but Adamz able to counter to a spine buster. Now again, he's going back for that submission hold, and it rolls through. Doing everything he can to take that damage off. Going for another big boot. Catches him in the chest there. Not really a solid kick. But it's enough to stagger Landon. Looks like he's going for an exploder suplex. Hale down, back. Appears to be killing him. Crowd trying to wheel him on. Will they have enough will to share to keep him in this match? And now he's doing a bit of an exchange in the ring here. Comes off the ropes with a little momentum. This time it's Adamz. Put him on his side with a forearm shot. Oh my god, big open hand slaps now. Now it's just getting insulted. It looked like they were about to do a double knockout. Still on their feet. Pile driver, perhaps. No counter. But Adamz holds on. Trying to put a cover. No. Hale able to get out of it. Sunset flip. Trying to get another pin. Adamz sits down. Counter by Hale. They are going back and forth. You know that these two men know each other extremely well, and they have done this before. They've done this dance before. Roll through. Not enough. They are looking to end this as quickly and efficiently as possible now. The pace has picked up, but how long can they maintain it? Adamz out there failing to get that pin rolled to the outside. I think he needs a breather. Think about what he's going to do next. Here comes Landon. He walks into a forearm shot. Adamz comes back in, a chop. Spinning out the legs. One more cover. And he's got the ropes. Referee Reese saw it. He caught him. Not going to slip it by this time. That's a good call by the referee. You see Eric saying, I'm sorry. You know his feet didn't get caught on those ropes by mistake. It was intentional. He was trying to score a cheap win like he's done the previous two times that he went against Eric Adamz. Oh! Adamz called with the bonus bomb. Two. No. And you can see some concern there now. That is the go-to move by Landon Hale, and it wasn't enough.
Go for it again.
Again, I have to say it just as much as I did a second ago. That's a good call by Reese. Even though it is not a popular one for the fans, it is a good call. Adamz came out of that full Nelson bomb by Landon Hale. It looks like Hale's going to try to go for it again. Counter into that short arm clothesline. Hooks the leg. Two and... It is only the will to survive that is keeping them going right now, folks. Only the will to survive. Careers are on the line, and they are not willing to give it up. Eric's trying to kick this thing into another gear now. He just took off his sleeve. The Puerto Rican flag, and we know how much that means to a short-arm clothesline. Full impact, and not enough. I mean, he caught Landon good. You can see he's still gasping for him, but it wasn't enough. It was not enough. Eric Adamz is the real. If you had a way to look inside of what he was thinking, you would see the wheels turning right now. What can I do? What can I do to keep him down? Versus says Adamz into the corner. Tries to charge him, but he gets shot out over the top rope, but David does not keep him down. Forearm shot, springboard stunner, a slingshot stunner, and that's not enough either. It was a beautiful maneuver. I'm not even sure if I've seen a slingshot stunner before. Landon hit it, and it wasn't enough. He's saying it should have been three. And I think that most of those people out there in the crowd would be inclined to agree. But most of the people in the crowd are not the official. The decision will come down to one man by the efforts of one other man. Going for a super kick. And wow, Adamz caught the super kick. And, oh. It was a beautiful super kick. Wonderfully measured, but not enough. Eric Adamz continues to surprise me and fans and everybody else that watches his matches and the things that he is capable of doing. To the top rope, this is something different. You don't see Eric Adamz going up there often, but I guess desperate times call for desperate measures, and that high-risk maneuver may have just worked against him. Got caught. Landon's getting up there right now. Looks like he may be going for a superplex. Yes, it is. Looks like Hale caught a bit of himself on the way down. And that is a high drop. I know it doesn't always seem that way or feel that way when you're looking at it through a video score. But believe me, folks, it is higher than most people imagine. He goes for the cover. But no, not enough weight on the shoulders to keep Eric Adamz down, and perhaps the twisted wheel of Eric Adamz is more than enough to keep him going as well. Both men have displayed frustration, concern, begging the referee almost. This has to be three. Adamz waving his arm around, making sure that he's still alive. Hale trying to get himself together. Trying to find that next move to put this thing away. Forearm shot by Eric Adamz, returned by Landon Hale. They are still exchanging in the middle of the ring. Big chop. It is also returned. Slap in the face. It's like Eric Adamz is delivering. Hale is returning, but he didn't return that barrage of shots nor the German suplex. No. He had a barrage of open palm strikes, turned Hale around, caught him with a German suplex, and even that did not keep Landon Hale down. Crowd cheering Landon and trying to, this period of his speaking, transfer some energy, some power that he can utilize. Double close that says both men. Get this man to will himself into a victory. Both men had the same idea there, went for a clothesline. They managed to nail each other. Referee is checking them both. You have to wonder what would happen if they went to a double countout. What would take place then? I don't know if that certainly won't be the case now as Hale's getting back up to his knees, getting up to his feet. Eric Noster getting up as well. Well, in Memphis, that means something. When the straps come down, it means it's time for business. Eric is certainly trying to deliver that as well. And these two guys are just delivering clotheslines to each other. Neither man going off his feet. A rink of the eyes. Shortcuts again into the ropes, stuck underneath the clothesline, and a big clothesline by Landon Hale says Eric Adamz had a reverse elbow. As much as he was being able to stand up to the punishment before, he can't do it now. Reverse by Adamz sends it, Landon Hale out to the floor. back up to his feet is Landon Hale. And you look at the expression on his face now. He is not going to give it up. He's going to fight with everything he's got, folks. He stops an assault by Adamz. Adamz looked like he was trying to get him a headbutt against the post. Out the top rope. No, my gosh. Big mistake there. Adamz got out of the way and Reese caught every bit of that high cross body. Over the top rope this time. Landon was not able to brace for that impact. He's down on the floor. There are no mats. There are never any mats in an APCW event. That is just hard floor. If you've been in the basketball gym, you know what I'm talking about. Adamz, I think I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to revive the referee. There is no stipulation as to how you have to win. You just have to win. And I think Eric is realizing that. If he can get him to count and count Landon Hale out, he will be successful. Landon looks like he might have popped the back of his head. He's trying to get himself together. Now the count is on. Landon trying to pull himself together. The count steadily counting up here. You can hear some of the fans on the front row screaming, "Get up!" You can see it now. Landon manages to get back up to the apron. Shoulder block to the midsection of Adamz. Goes over to a sunset flip. Adamz trying to keep his balance. Tried to sit down on him with a vertical splash. Missed. And oh. Adamz just shoved Landon Hale into the referee. Oh, come on. Is it going to end this way? He's going for a cover. Oh. A three count off of a low blow. Eric Adamz has done it again. After multiple times in this match, he utilizes some underhanded, dirty tackle. He finally got the one that worked. A vicious, hard, low blow. You saw it plain as day on the camera, as did everybody else in this ring. Unfortunately, the official, the one that counts, did not see it. And I know that any man out there understands what that pain feels like. And after all of that, that's how it is.
I choose where my career ends. No one tells me when. I say, bye-bye, Al. Bye-bye.
And there was, and even despite the eye rates, the tip of the feet on the rope, I was going to say they were having a fantastic match, and that was the way that Eric Adamz decided to pull this thing off.
Unfortunately, due to the stipulations in the match, Landon must retire from professional wrestling.
Here it is, folks. That was the stipulation. That was what he agreed to. And I know this is everything that Landon Hale had been complaining about from the get-go. Now he would get so close, only to have the rug pulled out from underneath him by some tactic that Eric Adamz would do. And this is just another example of that. You can hear the respect of the crowd. Eric Adamz just robbed. I will go on record to say Eric Adamz robbed that man of the win. He did everything that he could do. Put up the match maybe of his lifetime. Definitely at this point, since he's now at an end, the match of his career.
One last time, big APCW round of applause for Mr. Landon.
Easily one of the brightest stars that APCW had learned to produce. And Eric Adamz just took that away. He took that away from everybody. Not only took it away, flaunted it in his face.
If you're stepping outside to partake in any tobacco products, please extinguish those in their proper receptacles. We would greatly, greatly appreciate that. Also, going to be your last chance here for the 50-50 raffle. I'll be walking around with the bucket here. If you have not picked...
Well, as they say, the show must go on. Very disappointing outcome. Come to this. Come to the APCW Championship match, the main event. Cannot dwell on the loss of the career. Now we have to focus on who will be the man going forward. You see right now we've got Sean Sims in the ring, the return of Alister Crowe's Angel. Angel, of course, Oliver Sims looking to regain and recapture the APCW Championship that he just lost not all that long ago. He plays it back into the camp of Angel's Army. This time, this match will be a little bit different. It will be a three-way dance. We got Sean Sims, we just saw in the ring. We have this young man, Chris Henry. Of course, the champion, due to come out any moment. Youngest champion in APCW history, Jordan Kingsley. As I just stated, this will be a little bit different in that I believe it is the first, and up until this point, only time that the championship here has been defended under three-way rules. Meaning, champion does not have to lose in order to lose his title. But apparently, Jordan Kingsley felt very adamant about pushing this match. Sean Sims wanted a title shot. Chris Henry also wanted a rematch, and rather than to take them on in succession of bumps, he and the management chose to do it one time. I guess in my book, that's going to certainly make him one of the boldest champions that APCW has had. He may yet go down as the most fightingest. This would be quite the matchup, folks. I mean, we got a former champion here. Sims, a top contender in Henry, and of course the champion ended up with a prodigy for the Kingsley. But how will it affect his game plan tonight as he slides to the curtains? Base out there, they have to come out to the curtains to meet their champion. Oh, they look like somebody held on to his wrist there. now, as he mostly always is, a motivated champion. He's a motivated competitor, just in the least, and he does carry the name of Prodigy with the reason. He's as good as they say he is, as he just effortlessly leaps up to the top rope, perched there right now. Backflip into the ring with the belt on. He's meeting his challenges.
Ladies and gentlemen,
let's go to the ring announcements.
Our main event for the evening, and it is for the APCW Heavyweight Championship. Introducing first, across the ring from me, escorted to the ring by the First Lady of APCW, Miss Angel, hailing from Billerica, Georgia, weighing in at 290 pounds, Sean Sims. To my left, hailing from Douglasville, Georgia, weighing in at 195 pounds, Chris the Hype Henry! And to my right, the reigning, defending, and youngest APCW Heavyweight Champion of all time, hailing from Queens, New York, weighing in at 185 pounds, your APCW Heavyweight Champion, the Prodigy, Jordan Kingsley.
Well, you just heard the ring announcements. And it's time for the main event.
Again, this match is for the APCW Championship. It is scheduled for one fall with a 45-minute time limit.
Sean Sims, who felt like he hadn't had his opportunity to regain the championship belt pretty much, as you see him rub the belt and touch the championship he once held, as does Chris Henry, who feels like it was supposed to be his time, his destiny. He should be the champion. He wanted a rematch. He was, oh, started out pretty hot. With an almost inverse power slam, just dropped Henry immediately. Now it is up to Kingsley and Sims as Henry goes out to the floor. And as I was saying, Henry wanted another opportunity, and Kingsley certainly had no issues with it. He immediately obliged. The fact that he obliged the two of them at once says a lot about the champion. First of all, Sims. Oh, my goodness. And Sean Sims is going to stand still and stand strong. He is the monster in the ring. She's within the two, and again, a flying shoulder tackle, not enough to take Sims down. Kingsley, I said, well, you give it a try. I don't know what the strategy would be here, because Sean is certainly the bigger and stronger of the two as he leaps over the top. And again, another effort by Jordan Kingsley. Tries, comes off, and you can see that Sean's like, no, sir. And it's like he's stalking his prey, waiting for him on a drop kick. That kind of take, that takes the big man off his feet, and here comes Henry. Shots at Sean as his cartwheel over the top rope. Jordan Kingsley, how good is the Prodigy? I mean, within probably inches away from people in the front row, but he is that good, folks. Takes out both of them at one time. Henry and Sims out on the floor, and now he does the exchange. Was in there with Sims, but now he takes in Chris Henry. As Alister Crowe comes around to check on his comrade in arms, Sean Sims, up to the top rope, Jordan Kingsley. Sizing up his opponent. Big splash from the top. Will that do it? Sean, lightning quick, comes in there and stops that guy. He moves incredibly fast for a big man. Chop. Here to sound off. There's a chop by Sims. Another one. You have to say, Sean does have a legitimate. Wow. I think that might have stunned Sean as well. He tried to charge in, but over the top rope he goes. I was going to say, Sean Sims has a legitimate claim on being a top contender as he has not gotten his rematch up until now. Nice suplex by Kingsley. Held him up there for a while before he dropped him down before covering. As far as the series is concerned, with Sims and Kingsley, it is one and one. So we'll add this onto the tally board, if you will. Trying to break free. Kick right to the chest of Jordan Kingsley. Come on there. Kingsley did it. Right there to the side of the face. Reversal. Big clothesline. As athletic as standing moves. As athletic as Jordan Kingsley has got to give Henry his due. Yep, Sam slides in, makes the save again. Certainly not going to allow a pinfall to occur if he can help it. Remember, it does not matter who pins who. This is not an elimination match. First person to score the pin will be the champion. As it stands right now, Henry and Sims are facing off against each other. And one big clothesline is all it took to get up by Henry. Trying to chop the big man down. And if either man is capable of securing the pin or the submission here right now, then they will be the APCW champ. Big short strength by Charles as he pulls him up, but Henry somehow managed to shift this weight and turn that into a DDT. I see Angel over there at the top of the side of the screen holding Sasha's mechanic. Now there's a graceful covering shot. Either Henry or Kingsley going to allow that to happen. Standing Falcon Arrow. Now it looks like Henry is the man to beat. Down. This is the point where he's going to want to take advantage of the fact that one of these guys are out cold. He charges in the corner, takes out Sean Sims. Sean looks like he might be out of his feet. Kingsley trying to pull himself up his handstand. He tried to come off with a spin kick. Sims caught, saw it coming and caught it, turned into an ankle lock. Or at least he's attempting to turn it into an ankle lock. Got him to fly now. He may get a submission. And he's trying to break the grip. Big right hand. He's now trying to pull Sean out of the corner. It needs to be said that of the three men in this ring, Sean is the one with the experience, at least in APCW, in a triple threat match. It is how he got his first championship opportunity to begin with. So just saw him charge in. He won a triple threat and went on to challenge the champion that night. As the video showed, he was within inches of winning the title. So if we were going to be betting people in this case, big slam by Sims. We'll say Sean Sims is the odds on favorite as he drops a big elbow right across the chest. Before he can make the cover, Chris Henry comes in, charges in that drop kick. Henry laying in shots on Sean. Kingsley trying to pull himself up to his feet on the other side. Henry just leaps into the arms of Sean. That might have been a mistake. There lies the power advantage of Sean Sims. Turn whatever Chris Henry was trying to do into a modified spine buster. Henry again, he's fighting from his knees, he's not giving up, but for the multiple shots that either Henry or Kingsley have been firing out, Sean is able to equalize that with one big blow. He's coming up from behind, stops the pinball, at least he can attempt.
nice uppercut by Kingsley. Lost the kick and a super kick by Kingsley. There we go. The clothesline was Kingsley. He's up on the knee right to the side of the face. Kingsley was on the knee. There you go. Hands to him. Just kind of back kick right at the top of him. Shows great reflexes by him, too. He's got the kick spun around, brought a kick right into the abdomen. That was a big maneuver there. All for the cover, almost. Pretty sure you can taste that championship win. Kingsley was not going to stay down just yet. Sean also has the benefit of having Alister Crowe and Angel on the outside to be eyes for him. Letting them know, hey, you got to get back in there. Big clothesline by Sean Sims. Drops Chris Henry right there in the middle of the ring. A gut wrench. Another suplex. Sims may be in control of his neck. Henry is down. It looks like Kingsley's down on the outside. Sims decides to go after the champion and not press the advantage on Chris Henry. Chop on the outside and Jordan retaliates. Double chop by Sims. A side kick by Kingsley. We see Henry crawling over to the ring apron. While we got the champion and one challenger preoccupied, high cross body from the apron to the floor, just as Sims inadvertently pushed Jordan Kingsley out of harm's way. Here goes for the cover. And a kick out. We got Angel and Crowe still circling around. Right now, their charge is not in play. Well, he just got back in, and Henry's trying to control him down the sides. Short shot, springboard to a drop kick, hits both men. Incredible by Jordan Kingsley. Soda block this time, he brings Sean down, clothesline to Chris Henry. Another soda block. Clotheslines and soda blocks, taking both men down. Sean as a weapon almost. Tosses him into Chris Henry, goes for what we commonly refer to as a zigzag. He breaks up the pin. Kingsley. Got two targets out there on the floor. Which one did he go for? That's it. Any questions? Henry back up to his feet now, so I guess he's no longer a target. He's in. Great athleticism by Henry. Leapfrog to the top rope. Catches him with a complete shot from the top to the mat. And that could be it. Crawling over to get that pinfall. Drapes his arm. Sean Sims. Again. Breaks up that pin. All three men down, all three men hurt, all three men tired. The APCW Championship is still on the line. It is the championship that should systematically get you out further into your career. Springboard. Here's what he was looking for. Springboard off. Come off with that side kick to the side of the head. Roll up by Kingsley. No. Bryan Brock is in for an hour. He's getting himself hyped up, I would imagine. Blocks the shot. He's raining blows in right now. And kicks the back elbow. Kingsley may regret taking on a triple point at this pace.
That was kind of position. To a gut buster. Sean getting back up to his feet. That's a way to put the back of the head with a hands in carry. To the ropes. This elbow by Henry. Henry in full control of this matchup right now. He is calling for it. Board himself on the outside end with that face plant, perhaps. Yes! He just spiked the head of Jordan Kingsley into the mat. I have to believe that that would have done it if Sean were not there. But just as Sean was there to break up his pin, Henry was there to break up Sean's. As it just said, the decision to take on both of them at once may be of regret before this is over by Jordan Kingsley. Yes, Sims utilizing that power, horse him up, and Henry finds his way out of it and turns it into an SST, severe skull trauma. Over the cover. And Crowe. There lies the difference, man. Kingsley was not able to get over there in time, and Alister Crowe saved the match. I'm sure he didn't do it for the benefit of Jordan Kingsley. He did it for the benefit of Angel's Army. And there's an insecure by Kingsley. He drops Jordan Kingsley, sends him down to match. Henry is up on his feet. He is the last man standing so far. And Henry is now getting distracted by Crowe as he knows he had the match potentially won, but Alistair stopped him. Now Sean Sims with that big slam. Sean slam. Spinning Uranage that he likes to do, and that he has finished off many an opponent with it so far. It could be his big coup de grace for this match, but Kingsley's back up to his feet. He just caught Sean in the side of the head. I think that might have rattled him. Now Kingsley looking for something big. Again, he's got his choice. Alistair's over there trying to get Sean back up to his feet. Top rope. A second big splash on Chris Henry. He hits the mark. And there's the three count. Sean did not react in time.
And still, your APCW.
Tight moments, perhaps scary moments for Jordan Kingsley. He manages to survive and retain the APCW Championship. He is still the man in APCW.